that I am not Neil Diamond coming to talk about Guiomar Novaes. Wherever I go, I have to sign his autograph, although I have never even seen a photo of him or heard a record. I'm really deeply honored to be the opening moments of the Extraordinary Festival Miami 1996 in its 13th season. The whole festival is magnificently programmed and is a cultural jewel. Miami should indeed be proud of it. I'm most pleased that the theme of the festival is in tribute to the great Brazilian pianist Guiomar Novaes, whose centenary is being honored. I'm gratified that she is being remembered. It is so easy, too easy, to forget the labors and deeds of the great performing artists. In the world of the performing artist, one can say, first to the living, even with recordings assuring the immortality of dead performers, they are quickly relegated to the limited historic bins of the record emporiums. And their motto surely is, first to the living. Certainly this is important and natural, as the living are the ones who bring to us their flesh and blood to the concert stage. They are the link to the survival of the musical art itself. But the fact is, the great performers are too quickly forgotten, and it is important to remember them, to hear their recordings, to know who was here before us. Recently, I was talking with a record executive, and I was asking how the vast recorded legacy of Claudio Arrau was faring. The great Chilean pianist had died in 1991. Well, I was told by the executive, very poorly, hardly anything sells, he's dead. We can't put money into him. These are hundreds of records, thousands of hours of work, tremendous artistry, but we can't put money into him. So I said, well, you know, I did 6 marvelous interviews with the great pianist, and they're just hanging around on my shelf. Why don't you put them together, make a CD out of them? Because he had the most gentle and wonderful voice imaginable, and his knowledge was extraordinary. Put it on a CD for some promotion. He'll be 100 years old in 2003. Not a chance, I was told. Oh, we wouldn't do that. We have to promote the new ones, I said, even if they're not great. Oh, yes, absolutely. A row is through. And so it goes. These recordings of the past greats continue to live only because a few connoisseurs keep the flame alive, keep listening, and they keep learning from their art. And thus the records somehow are still broadcast on radio stations, somehow they're in secondhand stores. But sooner or later, Phillips will take out all these CDs and he will be on the historic discs and it will be over. I was looking for Guiomar Novaes CDs. I know there are some. I went to 3 large New York stores. Just to get someone to help was incredible because, well, first of all, they thought I was Neil Diamond. Why would I be looking for Novaes recordings? And of course, no one really worked in the classical section at all. Well, they said, let's look on the computer. I hate all machines, by the way, except the piano. No, machines hate me. They know I hate it. They hate me, and they crumble whenever I come near. Anyway, so the person, of course, all people now know how to use these machines. You have no choice. And there she is. It's incredible. All of her recordings are there. But none of them stopped. They're listed. I said, oh, that's too bad. What, she's in the computer? He was very proud of that. I said, have you ever heard? Because I take little surveys here and there. Have you ever heard of Madame Novaes? Oh, no, no, no. I said, Madame Novaes. And he said, yes, he must have been very good. He's on the computer. No, it was a woman, I said. And indeed, by the way, the theme of this little lecture is women pianists beside Novaes. The real fact for me, of course, is I will get those CDs. And I have her LPs. And I've heard her on all the recordings she made, almost. And I heard her live. And I never want to forget Guiomar Novaes, because she was a genius. She was a genius of her instrument. She possessed a golden tone. She was a poet and a high priestess of magic. And as I'm a pianist, and I love the piano with a demonic passion, Guiomar Novaes is my family. She's my blood. She's a part of my tradition. And that's the key word. Unfortunately, we live in a world where tradition and continuity are dying fast. It's a traditionless world suddenly. Suddenly, it's all taking place very suddenly. She wouldn't have believed it. But without tradition, we lose all sense of worth, all. And we lose discrimination. America is an amazing land of very little discrimination, but it is an egalitarian nightmare. I am not pleased when I ask my Juilliard classes, each of these kids fighting for a little place in an artistic arena, ever shrinking, going to these ridiculous cannibalistic competitions, imagine art. Piano playing, competitive. Who is better? Well, of course, everyone will become homogenized so they can win. But my students have never heard of Novaes. Dead only since 1971, nine. They have not heard of so many, it's incredible. Yes, they're young. But there are so few that bring back the memory to them. So all of them want to be stars. And they never speak about, oh, do I love this Chopin concerto. They will learn that because that's the competition piece. You see, this is a different time. And they forgot that these people, these artists were once great stars, adored, feted, followed. People went home and they practiced the same pieces of music. They ached their betters. So it's important that the new generation remembers these great artists. But tonight, at least, for all of us, for this concert, for this festival, Guiomar Novaes lives. And as long as we remember her and her colleagues, we will partake in the richness of the individuality they possessed. Individuality they possessed. As long as we listen and discriminate, we will be protected from the prevailing zombiehood that is sweeping over our irrelevant information highway. Now, I'd like to say something about being a good pianist. I don't think there is anything as difficult as that. I may be wrong, because I'm wrong so much of the time. Because of its soloistic being, it has been given a literature so vast, so immense, and so difficult that one can take a small segment and work on it, practice it, analyze it, meditate upon it through eternity and beyond. I dare say something that is seldom said, but that I now know. It is so awesome a task to be a very great pianist, physically and psychologically and artistically, that there are and have been fewer great pianists than there are, for instance, great poets, great painters, or pieces of music. There are many more great pieces of piano music than there are great pianists to play them. Maybe a new thought. The reason is it is just too difficult to play the piano well. The piece of music may have been composed in a blessed hour. The artist playing it works on it relentlessly for a lifetime, ever changing, ever growing, getting worse, getting better, but always in flux. The artist pianist has a conception, an intention, but the realization may be far from the intention. And always the moment may not work, may not be right, may not be conducive. To play in public is so glorious, so giving, but so precarious. I'd like to read a little bit from my own book, The Art of the Piano, which I'm quoting Alan Wheelis in his little book, How People Change. He's a psychologist, and it's about how Richter, so terrified to come on stage, and yet this granite jaw, this immense, almost like Michelangelo type man, strides out on the stage. His face is grim. There is anger in the set of his jaw. But not at the audience. This is a passion altogether his own, a force with which he protects what he is about to do. If it had words, it would say, what I attempt is important, and I go about it with utmost seriousness. I intend to create beauty and meaning, and everything, everywhere threatens this endeavor. The coughs, the latecomers, the chatting woman in the third row, and always those dangers within, distraction, confusion, loss of memory, weakness of hand, all are enemies of my endeavor. I call up this passion to oppose them, to protect my purpose. And now the great Richter begins to play. And the anger I see in his bearing, I hear in the voice of Beethoven. It knows nothing of meanness or spite. It is the passion of the doer who will not let his work be swept aside. It hurts no one, this anger. It asserts life. It is the force that generates form. So if one's effort works, and you've played well, if you've communicated deeply to an audience, you've certainly accomplished a great thing, the gap from intention to realization. But still, the artist is not happy. even if it's a wonderful performance, wondering if they can achieve that glory again. An interesting story about Laurence Olivier played a tremendous Othello, and they had a party afterwards, and he was in despair in his room, and they kept, "Larry, come on out. Larry, it was the greatest performance of your career." He peeks out and he says, "Yes, I know, but can I ever do it again?" But to achieve that greatness is the oasis, the flowered land, the fulfillment of those parched and lonely hours, fighting, pushing back one's limitations, stretching and enlarging one's technique, learning to understand one's own hands. And each hand has its specific problems. There's no perfect hand. Each hand has its limitations. Once Leopold Godowsky, who had very small hands, but was one of the supreme technicians that ever lived, was asked how he played with such small hands. He replied, "Madam, who ever said one plays the piano with their hands?" I'd like to bring up the fact also that Guiomar Novaes was not only a great pianist, but she was a female pianist, a woman. And to build a sustaining career being a woman is no small matter. Anything. Once I was talking to the legendary Brazilian pianist Magda Taliaferro, born slightly before her. And she played in New York in 1985, and it was the first time she played in the United States in over 40 years. And I was interviewing her at the radio station I was music director of at that time, which is now, of course, a rock and roll station. 20 years I worked very hard. I knew they'd get me. I just was amazed it took them so long. And I asked Taliaferro, "Why haven't you played in America during these years?" "Oh," she said, "I would have loved to. But Novaes owned America. And there was room only for one South American woman pianist, just as there was room for only one British woman pianist, Myra Hess, Dame Myra Hess." It's a very tricky and nebulous matter, the building of an international career, which can sustain itself for decades. It takes unswerving professionalism, dedication, luck, and the ability to create a bond with your audiences season after season. Novaes had this indefinable thing, and what is so interesting, she never really tried. It happened to her from the beginning. Novaes was a guileless woman, kind to her colleagues, always modest. If she missed some notes, something unusual for her, because she worked relentlessly, she said, "The good Lord made me make the mistakes, so I shouldn't be conceited." She attended Mass regularly and prayed before each concert. She once said, "I have deep faith that the divine power will never let the bad spirit triumph." When we think everything is bad, then comes the hand of God. Don't you agree? I'd like to continue with a bit of remembering the past and talking a little bit about some women pianists of extraordinary attainments and how interesting, in a world which has greatly, greatly repressed women's attainments, the piano was a female accomplishment par excellence. For the Victorian girl, it was almost as important before marriage to play the piano well as to be a virgin. But somehow, women in every country persevered and became more than a dilettante or more than just playing at it. They entered the profession of the male pianist. And if there was one fine woman pianist, although so many of the young women had to play the piano, there were always so many more male pianists. Most of these women pianists historically of interest are deserving of historical study, of biography, of research, and many have tried, and you know what the problem is? Well, if they had been men, it would be much easier. They would be easily documented. And even though during their lifetime they were often famous, just like any performer can be famous, but since they were women, their letters, their documents, their diaries, and so forth, were often not preserved. It's not easy to find out about certain pianists because there's just not enough information, even though they were world famous at the time. But women have had an enormous place in the history of piano playing, of teaching it, of organizing it. I don't think there would be a musical career for anyone without the women organizing clubs and making certain people came to concerts. So I want to pay tribute to a few of them. I want to just talk of them very briefly. Most of these names you won't know. But now you will, at least for a minute, and that's the idea. You bring back the continuity. I want to start with Maria Anna Mozart. She was born in 1751, 5 years before her titanic brother, the most wondrous prodigy in the history of music. Well, she was a girl, and although she was precocious and although Leopold said, she's by 11, she's the best keyboard player in Europe already. The little boy got the teaching. They were inseparable, Maria Anna. Nannerl was her nickname. But she was relegated to go back to Salzburg, get married, not be too happy, not continue her studies, because even in the stagecoach, Daddy would take out little Wolfgangus and he would learn how to compose better each day. But the girl was just in the carriage. She wasn't as important. And then when she got a little too old, she wasn't even asked to be on the tours. So she's a tragic case. She lives till 1820, she outlives her brother by 30 years. She marries, it wasn't a happy marriage. She became poverty-stricken and blind. But we don't know a damn thing about her, and what an interesting biography it would be. Let's go into the 19th century. It's truly the age of the great pianist, and the piano itself is now blossoming into the modern, great, extraordinary instrument of 23,000 parts. Clara Wieck, one of the great prodigies of all time. She married Robert Schumann, one of the craziest men that ever lived. She had to go against her father in a court of law. She had to, and she loved her father who traveled with her, but it was a hard life for her. Let's take a look at Clara. Robert decided he was the major genius. Don't compose anymore, Clara. We have one piano. Don't practice. He was a real chauvinist. Don't practice and don't play. Even if we're poor, I don't want you to have all this glory. Oh, but come to me once. Come to Russia with me. I mean, you know, there's so much money and we need it. He hated it. She was famous. She did his bidding, she practiced, and the letters are so terrible. Will I still be able to play? I have only an hour sometimes a week. She was pregnant 10 times in 13 years. And this woman, after he died, she's only 36, when he died in 1856 at 46, she's the greatest executant musician of the 19th century as a woman. She became a great role model. She was an amazing person, not only the great friend to her husband, the propagandizer of his music, but Brahms' close friend. And that woman play 4 and 5 concerts a week after that man died of insanity in 1856 by self-starvation. She was heroic. 4 and 5 towns a week to feed the 8 surviving children, Felix being the last child, named after their close friend Mendelssohn. And let's look at Fanny Mendelssohn. What an extraordinary talent. She was not allowed to be the composer and pianist. Everyone said, even Moses Mendelssohn, her grandfather and liberated philosopher, said it's not the place of a woman to be in public. And yet she brought more of the great masterpieces to Berlin on the Sunday concerts, even though she had amateur status, than anyone. And Fanny Mendelssohn died in 1847. Not even 41 years old. Her music, fortunately, is starting to be heard. And there's a wonderful, wonderful letter that Felix writes home when he is playing at Buckminster, what is it called? Palace. And Queen Victoria and Albert. Of course, they had to cover the piano legs. It was too sexy. But both of them very musical and worked very hard at it. The Queen sang a song, and the letter is so amazing because the song was not his. She thought it was, but the song was by Fanny. And it was under his name. And he was embarrassed and had to say, this is my sister's song. But he was not embarrassed enough to not ask the great queen and eventual empress of India to sing one of his. He wanted very much Victoria to do that. Let's look at another woman, Camille Pleyel. She is in Berlioz's biography. She's born the same year as Schumann and Liszt and Mendelssohn. She was one of the most beautiful women of the time. Berlioz wanted to come back from Rome because she had jilted him and he was going to wear female clothing, get back in Paris and shoot her. Well, the great Norma paraphrase of Liszt is dedicated to her. And Chopin's Nocturnes, Opus 15 is dedicated to her. And she went on to be the most important teacher in the Brussels Conservatory. And we know nothing about this fascinating woman, who practically is the inventor of all piano playing in Belgium. Let's look at Louise Farenc, F-A-R-R-E-N-C, 1804-1875. The first woman to ever teach at the Paris Conservatory, although she was not allowed to teach men. How interesting. And she fought. Her letters are so interesting to Aubert, the director. Why can't she have equal pay for her work? Maria Szymanowska was a Polish pianist who Goethe was actually in love with. She's 1790-1832. And she was, she did nocturnes and mazurkas before Chopin. She was an extraordinary woman. There's a fine poem that Goethe wrote to her and called her so incredible a pianist that even Hummel took a back seat to her. We know nothing about Maria Szymanowska, who is a fascinating woman. Arabella Bodard. She is one of the most important pianists in the world. She had a world career before anyone else. And in 1872, she left her husband. She had already astonished England when she was 16 by playing Beethoven's greatest sonata, the Hammerklavier, largest sonata from memory. That kind of thing was still incredible. And Godard left in 1872 for a 3-year tour. She was the first of the major pianists in the world to play in China, in New Zealand, That was a world tour of 3 years. She went on this Yankee Clipper. She went through the America, South America. She was indefatigable. Then there was Teresa Carreño. I want to just read a moment about her. She was 1853-1917. Liszt was overwhelmed by her. He called her my sunshine. She taught the American McDowell, and she was very, very important. She was married to D'Albert, who was her third husband, and he was a great influence on her playing. Her repertoire was extraordinary. She possessed a titanic technique, and few men could rival her animal vitality. She would play the Beethoven third, fourth, and fifth concerto in a single evening without a shrug. Claudio Arrau told me that he had never had heard in his career octaves the equal to Carreño. She was a good composer, she was an opera star, she conducted, but basically, and they called her the Valkyrie of the piano. She was very beautiful. James Huneker in his autobiography, and Huneker is the greatest critic of his time in America. He wrote, with her exotic coloring, brilliant eyes, and still more brilliant piano playing, Carreño was like a visitor from another star. Her manner of playing for me has always seemed scarlet, as Anton Rubinstein was golden and Raphael Yosefis was silver. Arrau called her epical, and decades later he still found her unforgettable. She was a goddess, Arrau said. I don't think I ever heard anyone fill the Berlin Philharmonic, the old hall, with such a sound. Well, she lived a tempestuous life, and I'm sorry that there hasn't been movies and biographies of her. And we can go on and on. I don't want to go too far, but I want to say that there's Agatha Bacher Grandel, who is a composer in some of her music, the equal of Grieg. She was a Norwegian. There's Annette Esipova. She taught Barrer, she taught Prokofiev. She was a wonder. There was Sophie Mentor, Liszt's favorite student. He was all born around 1850, by the way. Julia Rimet King, do you know that name? She roamed the United States in the 1890s, giving almost 4,000 recitals in her career. There was Chaminade. There was Maria Gell, a French woman of extraordinary attainments who taught piano to Albert Schweitzer. There's Wanda Landowska, who recreated the harpsichord single-handed with her first recital in 1903. There's Olga Samarov, whose name had to be changed to a Slavic-sounding name because she was from Texas and her real name was Lucy Hickenlooper, 1882-1948. And the manager said, no, Hickenlooper, please, it has to be Samarov. Well, she did very well that, and she taught William Capel, and she taught so many, Rosalind Turek, a great pianist. And there was Adele Osterhoff, who was the first woman to play in Carnegie Hall, the first performance in Carnegie Hall under Tchaikovsky in 1891, and she was a modest woman. Tchaikovsky conducted his piano concerto, she played it, she refused to take any applause, she wouldn't come back, Tchaikovsky begged her, she was a master. And there was, of course, Myra Hess, a gallant heroine who literally made 4,000 or 5,000 concerts of music in a London-starved World War II setting at the National Gallery. Everyone, every day, would be able to hear at 12 noon these programs. And there was the gallant woman, Hungarian Lily Krauss, who for 3 years was in a Japanese camp, an internment camp, without a piano. And it was a hard life there. And Maria Yudina, a legendary Soviet pianist, who even Stalin couldn't subdue, and with her courage, she played the music that was not allowed to be played of Schoenberg, of Hindemith, of Krinic. She was an amazing woman, Yudina. 1899, she died in 1970. Gabi Casadesu, the French wife of Robert, who's still alive, and so she can, in her 90s, in a great pianist. Marguerite Long, Clara Haskell, Rosalind Turek, Gina Bachhauer, Rosina Levine, the teacher of Clyburn, and John Browning. Closer to our time, Alicia De La Roche, the fantastic technician from Tasmania, Eileen Joyce, who would come out and between each concerto, she used to like to play three concertos, she would change downs each time, or between each piece. There was Anya Dorfman, the first woman to play under Toscanini. Fanny Davies, who was the first woman to play at Royal Albert Hall when it was inaugurated, the Emperor Concerto. Oh, it's an extraordinary cavalcade. Fanny Bloomfield's Eisler was called the Sarah Bernhardt of the piano. We have no recordings of her. Cecile Chaminade, who everyone played her music. She was fascinating. But now I want to conclude with my own article on Novaes, which gives a sort of critical concept of this great artist, 1896-1979. She had piano lessons from Luigi Ciafarelli until she was 14. She was born in São Paulo, Brazil. Soon after, she entered a competition for foreign students to attend the Paris Conservatoire. She beat out more than 200 applicants with her playing of Schumann's Carnival and the Chopin A-flat Ballade, among other pieces. The jury included no less, she's 14 years old, than Fauré, Debussy, Mashkovsky, and Isidore Philipp. And all were unanimously agreed that Novaes had a musicality of rare beauty. She proceeded to study with Philippe, who gently guided her persuasive individuality. At the age of 20 in 1916, she arrived in New York and took the town by storm after her fourth New York recital. Imagine playing four recitals today anywhere. She was heralded as one of the seven wonders of the musical world. J.W. Henderson of the New York Times wrote, "In the range of tonal beauties and immense vitality, only Paderewski or Hoffman could have equaled her." The inimitable phrase maker James Huneker, with poetic and geographical license, pronounced her the Paderewska of the Pampas. Another New York critic, the eminent Henry T. Fink, compared her to the great singers of the time. He wrote, "Her tone has the pure limpidness and beauty that the world adores in voices like Patti's or Sendrich's or Caruso's. In runs, these tones are like strings of perfect pearls." Novaes' playing was first and always personalized. She delighted in details, leaving one wondering why others never saw or savored them. Novaes, although trained at the end of a self-indulgent era, was in her way a quite scrupulous musician. Even at capricious moments, she had that marvelous and indispensable trait of a great interpreter, the power to convince. She possessed a fabulous pianistic flexibility. Her art was a compendium of the best romantic characteristics. The terms eccentric or idiosyncratic never applied to her. The term a natural did. She was meant for piano playing. Her hands belonged on the keyboard. Her playing at its best was as effortless as a bird in flight. She once said, "Piano playing for some is drudgery. For me, it is the greatest joy." But she was also a pianist of unusual discipline. The pianist Alan Tanner told me that he overheard her, even after 65 years of playing the Waldstein Sonata of Beethoven, practicing it slowly and scrupulously with the metronome ruthlessly beating. And Claudette Sorel told me, a pianist who studied with Samarov, that when she was young, the greatest thing had happened to her. She played in New York, and she got a wonderful review. The reviewer said, "Miss Sorel is a junior Novaes." 2 weeks later, Guiomar Novaes came to Sorel's recital. And she said, "I just dropped down. It was like royalty." And she said, "My dear, hello, how are you? I am the senior Sorel." She also heard her in the early 50s after a performance in I think, Carnegie Hall, after a rehearsal for the Schumann Concerto with George Sell, the orchestra left, the conductor left, and she thought no one was there. Miss Farrell and her mother were sitting in the back in the dark, and she took out her metronome, and she went through the whole concerto, thinking no one was there, so slowly, beating, and everything was exact. This is, and she always sounded so spontaneous, you see. Novaes was not a monumental musician, and she never played works not suited to her elastic tempo. Oh, I want to say one thing. Miami has a wonderful connoisseur of piano playing, a true pianophile, and his name is Julian Krieger. And I was asking about Novaes, and he said he had met her, but he had interviewed the great pianist Benno Moseyevich, and he was at the Y giving a series of three recitals around 1960. And somehow he had met Novaes, and after the last piece, everyone is applauding, and Novaes turns to Julian Krieger. Oh, she must have been a charmer. And she said, if you want him to play an encore, yell bravo. So Julian tells me, I yelled bravo, and he did it. I did it again, he came out and played it again, third time, he did it again. I was very happy. Next concert, he didn't see Novaes where he was, oh, she's not here today, she must be playing. Well, he did the same thing. After the concert, yelled bravo, Benno walked out, played, yelled bravo, went backstage to meet, to say hello, and there he was delighted to see the great Brazilian virtuoso. She was there. And she looked at Mr. Krieger and she said, you're in good voice tonight. In whatever she touched, there was a feeling of intimacy. And it was Chopin she touched most. Now, you have a fantastic recital dedicated to her, so I'm going to have to stop reading my review. If you want to buy the book, it's now in print again, Harcourt Grace. It's fabulous. The concert, by the way, is a typical Novaes concert. The last one I heard was in 1967, and I believe it was the last New York recital she played. As an encore, she played Gottschalk's horrendous music called, I mean, it's just so long, it's 12 minutes, it's musically horrible, technically absolutely astonishing, the Brazilian national anthem in the paraphrase by Louis Moreau Gottschalk, and it was a specialty of hers. The audience was in a state of shock. They were standing midway just to see the woman play. It was like the grand manner again. Well, tonight we have Barry Douglas playing a typical recital. One of her great pieces was the Chopin Third Sonata, the Pour le Piano of Debussy. She loved the impromptus of Schubert and the Appassionato. So when I tell you, you are in for a treat, instead of a treatment, remember the Viceroy commercial? You are in for a treat. It's true. And I want to thank you for listening to it.